John chapter 5 will be our main text. But John 4, you realize that in the book of John 4, there are so many things that Jesus did. It talks about Jesus came to the world and met the Samaritan woman. Praise the name of the Lord. He also came to a man whose son was dying. Amen. And so tonight the Lord is asking us, what do you want to change? And I want to ask you this question tonight. That I believe each and every one of us have some in our lives that we want to change. Amen. Amen. Who doesn't want change? If you don't need a change in your life, lift up your hands. We all do, isn't it? Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Okay, so we see that Jesus encountered the Samaritan woman, and the Bible tells us that this woman was indulging in certain things in her life. At a point in time, she thought that whatever that she was doing was right. The Bible says that she had five husbands, and even the one that she's living with is not her husband. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And so she encountered God to reveal it to her. She was living normal. Amen.
Amen.
The Bible tells us that this woman was engaging in immorality. One way or the other, she might have experienced shame, rejection by others because of her action. And I believe that we are likely to have to experience such a thing. Amen. Let me read a few scriptures, verses, and then draw a little bit light on that, and then jump into the main text. That is where I want to focus on tonight. The Bible says, Jesus knew the Pharisees and heard that he was baptizing and making more disciples than John. I'm using the NLT. Though Jesus himself didn't baptize them, his disciples did. So he left Judea and returned to Galilee. He had to go through Samaria on the way. Eventually he came to the Samaritan village near the field that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. And Jesus, tired from the long walk, sat weary beside the well about noon. Now, I wonder why this woman would have gone to fetch water at noon. Now, noon in our time is 12 o'clock, isn't it? Praise the name of the Lord. Now, you have to understand that the whole town knew who this woman was. They knew her. Amen. So probably, maybe she decided to go there to fetch that water because she doesn't want anybody to see her. Now, who goes to fetch water in the afternoon? Hallelujah.
Amen.
But the Bible says this to us, that soon a Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, please give me a drink. He was alone at the time because the disciples had gone into the village to buy some food. The woman was surprised, for Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaritans. She said to Jesus, you are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. Why are you asking me for a drink? Jesus replied, if you only knew the gift God has for you and who you are speaking to, you will ask me and I will give you living water. But sir, you don't have a robe or a bucket, she said. And this well is very deep. Where would you get this living water? And besides, you do not think you are greater than our ancestor, Jacob, who gave us this water? How can we offer better water than he and his sons and his animals enjoyed? Jesus replied, anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again. But those who drink the water I will give will never thirst again. it becomes fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them an eternal life. Please, sir, the woman said, give me this water. Then I will never be thirsty again, and I won't have to come here to get water. Go and get your husband. So this is where Jesus was trying to bring what she's indulging in. Jesus told her, I don't have a husband. The woman replied. Jesus said, you are right. You don't have a husband, for you have five husbands, and you aren't even married to the man you are living with now. You certainly spoke the truth. Sir, the woman said, you must be a prophet. So tell me, why is it that you Jews insist that Jerusalem is the holy place of worship and the story goes on and on? And then later on, this woman went to the town and then began to witness about this Jesus. Amen. Now, when you look at the same chapter, but what really struck me here was this fact. That you realize that, and I'll come to some points. You realize that this woman was very, very genuine when the Lord asked her. She was very, very sincere. When you read scripture, the Bible says that Jesus is certainly you are speaking the truth. Now, it comes to the theme that we are talking about now. What do you want to change in your life? Until we come to a place of being sincere about what we want. I want us to understand, if we are not sincere about what we want, there wouldn't be any change. This woman was very sincere. And because of that, you see that Jesus, at the end of the day, Jesus did not condemn her. Praise the name of the Lord. But in actual sense, an encounter with the Lord, she became an evangelist. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Okay, now look at the verse number 47 of the same chapter. Let's look at 46. As he traveled through Galilee, he came to Cana, where he had turned the water into wine. There was a government official in nearby Capernaum, whose son was very sick. When he heard that Jesus had come from Judea to Galilee, he went and begged Jesus to come to Capernaum to heal his son who was about to die. Jesus asked, Will you never believe in me unless you see miracle signs and wonders? The officials pleaded, Lord, please come now before my little boy dies. Then Jesus told him, go back home, your son will live. And the man believed what Jesus said and started home. Now, here we see that there's something about faith that the Lord was talking about. Amen.
Amen.
Now, I realize that many of us will go to the Lord because we think that God is a preference. Now, what I mean by preference is me having a whole bunch of, let's say for instance that there's a lot of me standing in front of you. Okay? There's 1, 2, 3 people standing in front of you. Now, each and every one has his own thing that he can do for you. Amen.
Amen.
Now, when you look at the one standing in front of you, if the person that you think that person can meet your need, that person becomes your preference. Now, we don't go to Jesus because Jesus is our preference. We go to Jesus because Jesus is actually our life.
Amen.
Are you getting my point to this? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yeah, because many a times that is what we do. We make Jesus like our preference. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus is not a preference. Jesus is actually our life giver. Amen.
Amen.
So look, I want to show you something in the scripture. So here, the Bible says this to us, that this person, this man, came and begged Jesus. Now, you understand that from the scripture, number one, initially, unbelief was there in this man.
unbelief was at work in this man. Because when you read the scripture, the Bible says this, then he believed. Now he didn't grab the word of God instantly. He didn't have faith instantly. Praise the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So until the Bible says, then Jesus told him, go back home, your son will live. And the man believed what Jesus said and started home. Many of us, that's the kind of life we want to see signs. I wrote this. Let me find it. I wrote something very. I said, do not be a wonder seeker who is waiting for a feeling or a sign. Amen.
Amen.
We think that until a man of God lays his hand on us, until we have this feeling, it means that we haven't encountered the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
See, Jesus didn't have to go. Now there is an instance in the scripture about Jairus where Jesus actually went. Isn't it? Jesus actually went into the house and laid his hand upon the daughter. Amen.
Amen.
But you see that even when Jesus went there, Jesus saw that the environment was full of unbelief. So he has to allow them to move out. Listen, God cannot perform with somebody who possesses unbelief. Mm-hmm. Actually, unbelief becomes a hindrance for God to perform.
Amen.
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 Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Uh-huh. And so here, the Bible says to us that then he believed. While the man was on his way, some of his servants met him with the news that his son was alive and well, and he asked them, when the boy had begun to get better, and they replied, yesterday afternoon, at 1 o'clock, his fever suddenly disappeared. Then the father realized that was the very time Jesus told him, your son will live. Amen.
Amen.
Why am I bringing this in view before we jump into John 5? It is very important for us to understand something, that we need to have faith in the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We need to have faith in the Lord. Now the scripture that we are about to read, you'll find something very profound in that. Let's read quickly. Afterwards, Jesus returned to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish holy days. We don't know which one was it. Whether it was the Passover or the Tabernacle or whatever. We don't know. Inside the city, near the sheep gate, was the pool of Bethesda with 5 covered porches. Crowds of sick people, blind, lame, and paralyzed, lay on the porches. Some of the men lying there had been sick for 38 years. And I want us to take note of that. When Jesus saw him, he knew he had been ill for a long time. He asked, would you like to get well? Would you like to get well? And I want you to listen to the response. We'll dive deeper in that. I can't, sir, the sick man said, for I have no one to put me into the pool when the water bubbles up. Someone else always gets there ahead of me. Jesus told him, stand up, pick up your mat, and walk. And instantly the man was healed. He rolled up his sleeping mat and began walking. But this miracle happened on the Sabbath. So the Jewish leaders objected. They sent the man who was killed. You can't work on the Sabbath. The Lord doesn't allow you to carry that sleeping mat. But he replied, the man who healed me told me, pick up your mat and walk. Now you realize that this guy doesn't know anything about Jesus. But I want to show you something. When the Bible says that, but Jesus knew me, turn to me in John 2. You will see that Jesus knew this guy all along, but this guy did not recognize who Jesus was. Yeah. He knew him. Jesus knew him. Praise the name of God. Hallelujah. I want you to follow me very, very, step by step. And so you see that in John 2, the Bible tells us this, that the same Jerusalem that Jesus was passing, all right, there were sick people there. Praise the name of God.
Hallelujah.
Okay. Now, when you come to the chapter number 5, as we just read. Now, Mama, please. If I'm to ask you, are you okay? Are you okay?
Yes.
Okay. Mama says she's okay. Are you truly, truly okay? Okay. Okay. That's the point. Okay. See, when I asked her, she said she's okay. But her response to me should have been, I'm not.
No.
It doesn't matter whether your leg or your arm or eye, you are not okay. Praise the name of God.
Hallelujah.
Okay. So now this guy that we are talking about, the Bible says 38 good years. Now I was wondering this. Listen on. He doesn't sleep there. The Bible never said he sleeps there. So in other words, we can establish that he goes and comes every day. Goes and comes every day. For how many years? 30 days. Amen. Beloved, we have to understand something. You know, there are certain things when you are doing continually and it's not working, you need a different approach. Amen.
Amen.
Because it goes and comes 38 good years. Now, you will blame this guy that why didn't you respond to Jesus? That Jesus, yes, I want to get well. But rather, you see that he was making excuses. Many of us, we blame people for our problems. Amen.
Amen.
I have been there. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Follow me. Okay. So the Bible said to us this, that would you like to get well? It was a question that Jesus was asking you. Now you see that Jesus also encountered a blind guy. And he asked this guy, do you want to see? Now, you see that the response of that guy was, yes, I want to see. But when it came to this guy, he was making excuses. Why? You are in pain and somebody is asking. Okay, let's move. I'll guide you. And so, he says, I can't say. The sick man said, for I have no one to put me into the pool when the water bubbles up. Someone else always gets there ahead of me. Amen.
Amen.
Now, please, I want you to jot something down. Number one, I realize that this guy has given up on hope. He has given up hope. Now, the Bible never said this guy was born lame. It was never mentioned in the Bible like that. Praise the name of God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Not like in John 9, the blind Bartimaeus, where the disciple asked that is it because of the sin of this guy or the parents? But Jesus says, no, none of them. But so that the glory of God will be seen. But this guy wasn't born like that. There's no way in scripture. I said it. There's no way. Amen.
Amen.
So in other words, so this guy has what? Giving up your hope. His state was hopeless. Now Jesus is not the only one that has been passing by him. So for him to have an excuse, he knows that ordinary people, let me tell you something, sometimes your destiny helper might seem very ordinary to you. Amen.
Amen.
He might seem what?
Okay.
Ordinary to you. You might not regard him. Praise the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
find you by it. So this guy was here for 38 years. He has been hearing that there's no way that he can walk again. Amen.
Amen.
So this thing has taken root in his life. He has agreed to his situation. He doesn't see that there's a possibility for a change. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You know, sometimes it feels very easy to stay in pain than for somebody to tell you, you get well. I've never been in that situation before. There's this guy that I encountered, he's my contact. And he had cancer. And he has to go through this chemotherapy. And he was telling me that his body has you have to put acid or something like that. And he says people keep telling him you'll be well. But he knows that it is better for him even to die. Hallelujah.
Amen.
When people are telling you it is well, you don't want to hear that. Because the devil has made it, you know, make you understand that there's no way. Amen.
Amen.
So this is how this guy also saw himself. Praise the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now I wrote this. That what is hurting you? Now before I agree that we need a change in our life. Okay? The change that I need in my life is different from yours. Amen.
Amen.
I'm not talking about a change where you tell me that your nose is not good, so you want to make your nose perfect. You can't tell me that because you think that God did not create you, you are supposed to be a woman, and so you want to be a transgender or whatever they call it. That's not what I'm talking about tonight. But I'm talking about something that you know that you need to change. Amen.
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 Uh-huh. Now I want us to know something here. That before I wrote this, before you can change, you must decide if you want to be changed. Please write it. I said, before you can change, you must decide if you want to be changed. Amen.
Amen.
If you want to let go of that unforgiveness, you have to decide that you want to let go of it. The reason sometimes, you know, we want people to force us, to persuade us. But it has to be something that you desire. Amen.
Amen.
If I'm having a fight, a conflict between my wife, okay, and Pastor Council Mama Dina, you tell me to speak to us. It shouldn't mean that because you spoke. It has to be something that there has to be this, how should I put it? Agency, there has to be that thing in you that indeed you want to let go. Amen.
Amen.
Not when they are born and then you say, it was a mama, not my dinner, die. Amen.
Amen.
In other words, what you are saying that you are not ready to let go.
Yes.
Amen. So that's why I said that before you can change, you must go. Decide if you want to be what? To be changed. Because that's where, when you look at the best of us, when Jesus saw him, he knew he had been ill for a long time, and he asked him, would you like to get well? So if he wanted to get well, he would have told Jesus that, yes,
yes.
I want to get well. Amen.
Amen.
If we do want to change,
We must decide to stop making excuses.
We have to stop making excuses. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because when we look at the verse in myself, he says, I can't, as I said earlier on, said the sick master. For. So he's blaming people. Always because people are going ahead of him. That is why he's not getting. Amen.
Amen.
We must decide whether we are ready to take action. Now you see that the word choice was placed before this guy. A choice either to become a victor or a victim. Are you getting it? Disciple, the way you are looking at me, you are not getting it. I said a choice was placed before this guy. It's either to choose to become a victor or a victim. You can choose to become victorious over that sin or become a victim of that sin. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So if we say, let's stop making excuses. It reminds me when I look at the book of Genesis. You know, the book of Genesis, when man sinned and God asked Adam, he says, don't blame me, don't blame me. Then the woman died again. Amen.
Amen.
What about the story of Moses? When he went to receive the 10 commandments, when he came to Aaron, as you know, made up. Aaron was blaming Moses. He says, you took too long. That is the kind of people we are. We always want to blame people for our actions. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Tonight, will you choose to become a victor or a victim? The choice is before you. Now, I wrote this that do you want Jesus to heal the part of your life where you've been hurt? Or you want to hold on to it? Eh? Do you want Jesus to heal that? Is that your desire?
Yes.
Then Jesus says, he says, one, Jesus, take up your mat. Take up your mat. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You know, listen, beloved, hear me. I will say that, see, you can only give someone, mama, what you have. Mm-hmm. Now, today's devotion, you realize that we took it from Acts 4. Now, Acts 4 is when John and Peter saw the guy at the gate of beautiful. Amen.
Amen.
Now, the Bible says this guy had an expectancy. All that he wanted was something that is perishable. But this, the Bible says that Peter said, silver and gold we do not have, but what we have is what we give. In the name of who? Jesus. Do what? Do you know why Peter came to that place? Now remember that Peter was the, when you read Luke 5, we know that Peter was a fisherman, isn't it? Okay. The Bible says they toiled the whole night and there's no catch. And to Jesus sat in the boat that belongs to who? Peter. And the Bible says to us that the Lord said to Peter, cast your net. But remember what Peter says, he says, at the word, I will let down.
Amen.
No, so Peter understood that the word of God is Jesus himself.
Amen.
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 And that's why he said, in the name of who?
Jesus Christ.
Rise up and go. It's very sad that when you read scripture, those that have diseases and all that sort of stuff, they don't have names. Even the blind Bartimaeus, that is not his name. That was his father's name. That wasn't his name. Praise the name of God.
Hallelujah.
So you see that all those people, even though they have names, but their names are not being mentioned. Why? That is their reproach. Praise the name of God.
Hallelujah.
I don't know your state, but I know that there's something that you want God to change in your life.
Amen.
Praise the name of God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you have an addiction, do you want to overcome it? If you have lust,
He wants to overcome it.
But I learned something about this guy. Friday, we'll go a bit more. But you see that this guy, he did something amazing. Let me try a little bit light on that. When you read further, the Bible says that, and then Jesus saw him in the temple. Jesus saw him in the temple. When I was reading this, see, they didn't attack the guy. Who did they attack? I want you to understand something. There's a picture there for you that we have. It means that what we deserve, Christ came and is doing for us.
Amen.
Praise the name of God.
Hallelujah.
Read it. Why can't I read that? Amen.
Amen.
Now, I was married 38 years. Now, when you read Deuteronomy, I said, I think somewhere in Deuteronomy, I think 2, it talks about 38 years, these people of the children of Israel were when we wandered in the wilderness. Hallelujah. Now, wilderness is a place of hopelessness. You might be in that place. The enemy is telling you there's no hope for that. 38 years, maybe yours is more. There's something that you are praying about. Praise the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Beloved, my word to you tonight is simple. Trust and obey.
Amen.
That is what God has said. Amen. Just trust and obey.
Amen.
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 The song right now says, trust and obey.
Yes.
For there is no
other
way. There's no other way. Just trust and obey the word of God.
Amen.
Let me pray with you. God's grace on Friday. Please, let's take a moment, just 1 minute. It's a question that the Lord is asking all of us this evening. Do you want to change? You know your life. You know the things that you and I, we are doing both secretly, knowingly, habitually, willfully, all that we are fully aware. If you have that yearning, that desire, that indeed you want to change, then I want you to speak to the Lord. Speak to the Lord. Beloved, you can't encounter Jesus and be the same. There's nobody in the Holy Scripture who encountered Jesus and his life remain the same. Ask him tonight. Let him touch every aspect of our lives. Beloved, personally, I know what I want God to change in my life. I know the very thing that I've been crying to him to help me. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus tonight. The Bible says, Lord, you know everything about your children. From the crown of our head to the sole of our feet, there is nothing that is hidden from you. Even in our secret place, that is what David comprehend. He says, when he goes to the deepest of the sea, he knows that you are there. We pray in the name of Jesus tonight. That Father, we don't want to be victims of the enemy. We have learned that there is a promise for us to overcome. We can overcome sin if only, my Lord, we'll humble ourselves and obey.
We pray in the name of Jesus tonight. Help us in our weaknesses, Lord. Every limitation in our lives, we bring it before you. Our holy helper, come and touch us. Take anything that will cause ignorance in our lives, anything that will cause stagnation in our lives. And Lord, let us pick up our mat and follow you daily. We bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Something gave up to the Lord, give good, give bountiful.